Exodus chapter 25, verse 8. And let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. Would you pray? God, I thank you. Make us a sanctuary, O God. Make us a place, Lord, that is proper and good for you to dwell. God, add your blessings to the reading of the word. Minister in this house today. You get all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. And let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. In James 4 and 8, it says, draw nigh to God, and guess what? He'll draw nigh to you. Amen. And as we present our body a living sacrifice, which is wholly acceptable unto him, which is our reasonable service, then he will come and he will dwell and he will make his presence known in our life. Amen. Can you imagine what it was like in the garden when God would come down in the cool of the day just to have fellowship with his creation? God has always wanted to have fellowship with his people. He has always wanted to come close to us and be near to us. And I'm so glad today that we can come boldly to the throne of grace in time of need. I'm glad that we can open up our spiritual arm and say, here I am, and know that he will come and rush to our need and minister to us. And I'm so thankful to know that today. So we see that in the garden, whenever God would come down and visit in the cool of the day, what I want to talk about today is veils, things that separate, things that keep us from being in the presence of God like we need to be. And because that sin entered the picture in the Garden of Eden, there was a veil that came down and there was a separation that occurred. Man who had once walked with God, man who had had that fellowship like we can only imagine, a veil came down and a separation came. Listen, if you have ever been in the presence of God, if you have ever felt the touch of God in your life, and that separation comes, nothing else will satisfy. Nothing else will ever touch you into that place like being in his presence. Amen. Amen. So we see that sin entered and a veil fell. Then once again we see in Exodus, God is trying to draw nigh to his people. He's wanting to have fellowship with them, and he does. God does so much, and we see this throughout history, how God does so much to try to come close to his people. And we see in Exodus chapter 24, verses 9 through 11, and if you haven't read this and you haven't really got this into your spirit, it is something to think about. Listen to this. It said, then went up Moses. Now, we all know, we've all been told all of our life, how that Moses seen God. How that he went up on the mountain, he was there 40 days and 40 nights, and how that when he came down off the mountain, his face shone because he'd been in the presence of God. And we've been told that all of our life. We understand that. But also, we have not, many of us, do not understand and know this. It said, then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and they saw God. That's what it says. You read it for yourself. They saw the God of Israel, and there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of sapphire stone, and as it were, the body of heaven in his clearness. And now listen, it was unmistakable God. I mean, here he was standing there on a pavement of sapphire and just glorious. It was unmistakably God. And they all saw him. And upon the nobles of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand. Also, they saw God and did eat and drink. And then in Exodus chapter 19, verse 11, it said, he tells them, he says, and be ready against the third day, for the third day the Lord will come down in the sight of all the people on Mount Sinai. Now, what an opportunity that these people had, but they pulled back. God was saying, I want to get up close and personal with you, darkness with a great voice, with a great voice, with a great voice. And he added no more, and he, God, wrote them in two tablets. Now what did God say? God spoke the Ten Commandments.
You've got to see this.
God spoke the Ten Commandments, and then he wrote it down. God wrote it down on two tablets of stone and delivered them to me. And it came to pass, when ye heard the voice out of the midst of the darkness, for the mountain did burn with fire, that you came near to me. He said, this is Moses. He said, you came to me, Moses, even all the heads of your tribes and your elders, and you said, this is what they said, behold, the Lord our God has showed us his glory and his greatness, and we have heard his voice. Out of the midst of the fire, we have seen this day that God talked with men. God talked with man and he lived. They have been told that they would die. And here they are, they have seen, they have heard God speak, and it says, now therefore, why should we die? For this great fire will consume us if we hear the voice of the Lord our God anymore, then we should die. For who is there of all flesh that has heard the voice of the living God speaking out of the midst of the fire as we have and live? Now, you got to get this picture. You know, we always say seeing is believing, but here they have seen, they have heard, and they said, we're going to die. No one can see God and hear God and not live or not die. They were alive. But even though they had seen, even though they had heard, they said, we can't do this. This can't happen. How many times has God showed up and done miraculous things, and people have been in the midst of it, and they said, this can't be happening. And a veil comes down immediately. What God wanted to do, how God wanted to show himself strong in behalf of his people, and they put up a veil and said, no, you can come this far, but don't come any farther. Listen, I want to come into his glory. I want to experience God. I want to experience God. I want to experience God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And yes, you do have to die. The flesh has to die. When you hear what God wants to say, and then you come tell us. How many times has people come to that place? They want to be around someone who has went into the Holy of Holies. What was it like? God said, you're welcome. You can come in. But yes, your flesh has to die. Your flesh has to die. You have to come to a place to where you are focused upon the Lord and the things of God. But how many times down through church history have we put up veils and said, God, I want this, but I don't want that. I want that, but I don't want this. I want all of God he wants to give me. I want to experience all that he has. Amen. And he's got so much more than what we are receiving. God didn't want to hide himself from his people. He didn't want to go behind the veil. He didn't want to go behind the veil. But because he said, okay, I don't want to make you uncomfortable. He just wanted to be so close. So he came as close as he could. We come into the house of God and we feel those spiritual doodads, and it's so glorious. And God is saying, I want to come closer. I want to come closer. I want to come closer. But then we'll close out and we'll go home and say, wow, didn't we experience God? And God is saying, there was so much more. There was so much more that I wanted to give you. There was so much more I wanted to do for you. But we've got to be hungry. So the veil came down. Time proceeds. And we see a young shepherd boy by the name of David, a man after God's own heart. Amen. And I read the scripture in Psalm 84:1-3. And David is, he's looking there in the house of God, and he sees the little birds flying. He watches and he sees them as they go, and they come, and they're bringing pieces of different material, and they're coming. And this is what he penned. He said, how admirable are thy tabernacles, O Lord of hosts. My soul longeth, yea, even fainteth, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh crieth out for the living God. Yea, the sparrow hath found a house, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young. Even the altars of the Lord of hosts, my King and my God. He was even envious of the little birds that were making their nest at the altar of God. Honey, when you and I come to the place to where we hunger to be in His presence, and we'll sacrifice to be in His presence, there is no telling what God is going to do.
Amen.
He could only imagine having access into God's presence day or night. And that's what God has given us.
Yes.
You don't have to be here at this church. You don't have to have a pastor around. Amen. You have access 24/7.
Yes.
You can go into the presence of God. You can be driving down the highway in your automobile, and all of a sudden you say, Jesus, and it feels like the glory of God just fills that automobile. And we can come and we can call upon the name of the Lord, and He's there, and that's what He wants to do. But so many of us, and so many times, we have put up veils, and God is saying, I want to come in. The sanctuary that God instructed Moses and Israel to build for Him, it had a piece of furniture within it, and it was called the Ark of the Covenant. And when that ark, it was a box, it was covered with gold, and there were cherubim on both ends, but the lid, the mercy seat, the covering, it wasn't just a covering of gold, it was solid gold. Oh, hallelujah. And what happened? Oh my, they made a place for God to come. And when Moses would come in, and what happened? God would come down on the mercy seat, and He would talk to Moses. Oh, glory to God. When you and I come to the place that we hunger to be in His presence, He will speak to us. Oh, you mean God will talk to me? Oh, yes. Yes, He will. But we have to make a place for Him. We have to make a place, whether it's this altar or whether we go in our house and we go into a room somewhere and we close the door behind us and then we get into the presence of God. Listen, it doesn't have to be a closet with a door on it. You can be amongst 1,000 people and you can usher yourself into the presence of God, and His glory will come down. Hallelujah. He will pull you close and you can experience His touch in the midst of a huge group of people. But you have to make that place for Him to feel welcome to come. Amen. Oh, thank you. Down through Israel's history, the ark, at times it was set in the tabernacle. There were times when they would move it. You remember the story how that they had went to war with the Philistines in 1 Samuel chapters 4 through chapter 6, and the ark was captured. And when God got through with the Philistines, They were ready to send that ark packing with gifts with it.
Come on.
Amen. That's another story. But whenever the ark ended up in Abinadab's house, all the time that Saul was king, he never tried to bring it back to Jerusalem. But when David hit the throne, he done everything he could to get the Ark of the Covenant back. And we read about how the presence of the Lord was there. And then later on we see how that God used Solomon and he built the temple. It was not just a tent like David's tabernacle. Just, you know, some animal skin and some material. But I mean gold, and jewels, and all the finery. But you know what? When I begin to read in the Word of God, when God began to reminisce about his visitation, he always reminisced about the tabernacle of David. And it wasn't no more than just a makeshift tent. But that's, God said, that's where I want to be.
Yes.
That's where I'm. And you know what that represents? That represents this old flesh.
Yes.
This old body. We are the temple.
Yes, we are.
Of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
And God is saying, I want to dwell with you. I want to come in where you are. I want us to sup together. I want to lift you up in the heavenly places. I want to take you where you have never been before. But you have got to open up your heart. You have got to make a place for me. You've got to pull the veil away. And he's wanting to do that. You remember how David, he tried to do it his way. And it didn't work. Listen, we can think of all kinds of programs. We can think of all kinds of things to do to bring God near. Bring God near. Bring God near. And we have a beautiful altar in him come. And we have someone to preach that is well educated and says everything just right and is a great orator, then that'll bring God. That'll bring God. And we bring offerings, huge offerings, then that'll bring God. And God is saying, no, I want to dwell in that tent. I want to come in that tent. I want to abide in you. I want to sup with you and you with me. And that's what he's wanting to do. But we've got to tear that veil down that is separating us from him. He's wanting to break forth into our presence. He's wanting to come forth into our presence. So that's what he's telling us today. So we see that once again, down through church or down through Bible history, they had put up barriers. They had put up barriers. And Jesus came. Jesus came. When Jesus came and he hung upon a cross, he fulfilled the word that said, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden, I'll give you rest. He fulfilled the word that said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen. And he opened up a door. And when Jesus hung on the cross and he bled and died and he cried out these last words, he said, it is finished. He was not talking about the pain. He was not talking about the humiliation. He was talking about what he came into this world to do. He completed it. Once and for all, it was done. And when he said, it is finished, then the veil of the temple was ripped from top to bottom. To the throne of grace, but God broke out. Oh, hallelujah! He broke out. So another veil was put up. Church now says, we Jews, we can have Jesus. He was a Jew. You Gentiles can't have Jesus. Put up a veil. It's just us. We're an exclusive group. And we're the only ones that can have him. Baloney! Because people are doing the same thing today. If you don't have a certain name over the door, and you are not, you can't come into his prayer. He won't come. That's not so. He came into this world, and he bled and died for me when I was lost in that dust. And on my way to a devil's hell, he ran down where I was.
Yes.
So what happened? On the day of Pentecost, when they got filled with the Holy Ghost. And it still wasn't over. Time goes on, and they still think they're an exclusive crowd. So, Peter gets a visit. He done fell into a trance. And he's waiting for him to fix dinner, sitting up on the roof. He done falls into a trance. God gives him a vision. Shows him all these animals. Tell him to slay the owner. I'd never tell him that wasn't holy. God said, you watch out, boy. Don't you call what I have cleansed unholy. People have set themselves up as gods that ought not to be, honey. There's only one God, and he's on the throne. Hallelujah. There is none who goes between us and him, and that name is Jesus, who is at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for us today. Hallelujah. So veil was put up. But there was no boy over there. He didn't have a pedigree. He didn't have a title. He didn't have a lineage. All he had was a hunger and a desire for God. He fasted. He done everything he knew to do. He blessed the Jews. He blessed the temple. He done everything. He gave alms. All of this. Wow, God sent an angel to him. To him? Yeah. I love this. The angel tells him about Simon Peter. That he's staying at a man's house. Tells him the address. If he'd have had an email or a cell phone, he'd have told him that. Amen. Tells him everything about him. And said, you go send for him and he'll come tell you what you ought to do. Now that's paraphrasing, you know that. And so, sure enough, he fell out on the roof, you know, he's waiting to eat, and now he's having a vision. About that time, and God tells him to go with him. Don't worry, don't question, go with him. Who is it? Gentiles. Gentiles. Come on. But he goes. He stands up, he preaches. What happens? A whole bunch get saved. Glory to God. They get filled with the same Holy Ghost. The same Holy Ghost that fell on the day of Pentecost when 120 Jews got filled with the Holy Ghost. And they got filled with the Holy Ghost. Now he's got to go back to Jerusalem. He's got to go back to the general council. And they're asking, well, what in the world? What possessed you to do something like that? Who was I that I could withstand God? And he began to tell, ooh, hallelujah, hallelujah. And the veil was rent again. Glory to God. Honey, it's time that the veil comes open.
the audacity to do? He's bringing people, streetwalkers in and saving them. Amen. He's calling people to preach while they're still in prison. No. Yeah. You know what he done with me? Under the influence of alcohol. He started dealing with my heart to get saved. And then you know what else he done? He said, I choose you to preach. A woman, uneducated, husband not saved. Yeah. Because he started tearing away the veils. And I believe this with all of my heart. God is raising up an army. He's raising up people out of obscurity.
Yeah.
He's going to put people behind pulpits that their daddy or their granddaddy wasn't preachers. He's going to give them an experience with God. It's not going to take them as long as it took me. Why? Because time is running out and Jesus is about to come and the veils have got to be torn away. He's going to use you. He's going to use you.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
We got to come to the place to where our ears are tuned into the heavens.
Yes.
And we say, here am I. Send me.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
I don't understand it all. But here I am. Send me. Would you stand across the table? I cannot tell you the people throughout this ministry that has come to me. I've had people get up out of the church. I'd be off in another state or wherever. And when they found out a woman was preaching, they'd just get up and walk out. It's okay. It's all right. But I've also had people come to me and say, God made a believer. You don't think that it would have been awesome? I would have thought it was the most glorious thing in the world. That God would have said, no, I'm going to call you to preach. And your wife is going to support you. He didn't do that. And I'm still saying that.
Amen.
Every head bowed. Oh, the presence of the Lord is in this place. There's people who have been wounded. They've been broken. They've run into veils this way and veils that way, barriers this way. God is starting to pull them away. And he's going to bring you through. You're here today. You may be here. You may be away from God. But today the Lord is touching your heart. Amen. Amen. Sister Holly, would you come and play the piano a little bit? You're here today and you're not here by coincidence. Maybe it's been a long time since you've been in church. But today, the veil has been pulled away, and you want to come to Jesus today. Is there one? I want to receive Jesus today. Come on, just step right out. Come on. Is there one? I want to receive Jesus today. Is there one? I want to receive Jesus. I want to return to my first love. I want to come home. Is there one? You want to come home today? Pray, church. There may be one in this house today that just wants to come home. I'm coming home. I'm coming home. I'm coming home. You won't even have to come up here by yourself. Somebody will come with you if you want to come. Is there one? Come on. wait just a moment. I want to come home. I want to come home. I want to give it all to Jesus. Is there one? And wait just a moment. Or maybe you're here and that veil that's in front of you, it's like an iron gate. It's like an iron gate. It might have been placed there by tradition. It might have been placed there by man. It might have been placed there of your own doing. But today, whom the sun sets free is free indeed. So today you want to be free. You want to be free. And you want to step out as a declaration. To step out. Say, I'm reaching through. I'm reaching through. I need your touch, Lord.